intro. There you go. Your deal, dude.
Fancy intro. I didn't realize I didn't print your bio, so I can't even read it. I have to wing it.
Bonjour. Thank you all for being here. This is the third and final workshop for our first foods winter program now that it's finally turning to move into springtime. I'm Marnie, cultural preservation specialist with 1854. Really been awesome to have you guys here this winter and to meet all of you, and we've had like a core group of people come in every time, which is awesome. Next year I'd like to focus in a little more on, instead of field to table, field to studio, more art related stuff. So keep your eyes peeled. I'll make sure that it gets announced December, January, February. Today we have Tess Bailey here from Grand Portage. She's their,
Nutrition Education.
SNAP Nutrition Education Coordinator?
I'm in. Coordinator, grant manager, teacher, you name it, I do it. Yep,
and she's awesome at it. I know that I've told you guys before that the first time that I got to meet Tess was at Sugar Camp last year when she made bannock on an open fire for the kids at the camp, and I thought that was so sweet, and it was using all of the stuff that they grew in their garden.
Nice.
Pretty phenomenal. And she had her whole setup of all the cast iron pots.
Kitchen.
Yeah, we're good to go. So again, if you guys want to grab a plate to eat, do we serve cedar tea now or do we wait?
I think anybody who's brave enough to try, it should be good. And as it sits, it's up to a boil again, so let it sit and steep. I don't know, maybe it's defective cedar.
Oh no!
it'll sit too. And steep, and it'll get more of a, like I said, the recipe says a golden color. It's kind of a nice light green, a bright green. I've seen it done that way when it was made into iced tea. The more golden it gets, the more flavor it has. The medicinal value is there, so anybody wants to give it a go? Go light on the maple if you want to taste it.
Put my tobacco down, it should be good.
Yeah.
It's certainly boiled enough. It's sitting there in hot water, it should steep out and get nice and flavorful. I even put a little extra new green in there. So it's extremely medicinal, good for you, regardless of how it tastes. But actually, I think it tastes fabulous. So, I am the SNAP nutrition educator that used to be the old food stamp program. Food stamp program is where you get the food stamps. The SNAP Ed was designed to go along with that to help people on a low income make really better choices in the food, and how do you take this $17 and still be able to feed a family, and creative ways to use the foods that are cheap enough to be able to afford and use them well, make better choices. So my boss when I started was at MCT, and her first push to me was with school gardening and farm to school. It was the time when it was really going. And I kind of had mentioned, oh, I looked at her plants in her office and talked a little about gardening, and she grabbed this little thing and she said, you need to go. And it was the National Farm to Fork, Farm to Cafeteria Conference in Burlington, Vermont. I came back with my hair on fire, so excited. Hopefully, it's working. So, Grand Portage Food Sovereignty Project. We started off with a bunch of people doing a bunch of stuff, and eventually we were smart enough to say, hey, you're doing it, maybe we should talk. It's about the process and how we did it. So you're working with ECMO. How about the rest of you? What do you do? Why are you here? What do you want to know?
I'm a band member. I just always want to learn more about everything, I guess. My goal in life is to never stop learning. So.
Awesome.
I'm his wife, and I'm just along for the ride. I want to learn too.
All right, the two of you. I've seen you before.
Well, my wife Christine, she's the food expert in the home. I'm a tribal member, Delaware Tribe of Indians, and I work in historic preservation. And remotely from my tribes in Oklahoma tribe. And we're residents here in Duluth, and I sort of integrated with the native community here. And this stuff is important to me. And what 1854 Treaty Authority does is important to me. It should be important to all Indians.
Just understanding it is key. I mean,
protecting
all of
it
us,
is key.
It doesn't matter Indian or not, I think all of us should understand it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, hopefully you'll get something out of this. And if you have a question, please ask me. I don't mind being interrupted. And hopefully I won't talk too long. So, why food sovereignty? That's the big issue, the big words. Everybody's excited about food sovereignty. And we started as the Food Sovereignty Advisory Committee, or team, or group, or we had a lot of trouble figuring out a name and nobody could remember it anyway. Food sovereignty. The idea, whoops. Okay. Well, that didn't work. Okay.
Uh-oh.
They were supposed to pop up, but they're not popping up. So the first thing was, what is food sovereignty? It is, a definition is the right of a people to decide what foods, where food, that's it. So the inherent right of a community to define its own food system within traditional, cultural, and historical contexts. This applies to everybody, not just indigenous cultures, but any community of people has a right to say, this is the way we want our food system to work. And if you look around at the current system, we have 8 or 9 companies that tell us all what we shall eat, where, when, and how. There are about 9 companies that own the world's food supply. They control the food you get, when, where, and how, for the most part. We all have a right to say, no, I don't want that. What happened when we went to up there with some of the community members, they said, okay, Rick Anderson, what does this mean? This means that in day-to-day living, I have access to healthy, affordable, and sustainable food on my own land, on my own terms. So Rick Anderson is one of the elders up there. He's been in the community forever and ever, born and raised up there. He's a gardener. He's a physical therapist. He's about holistic health. That's what he said. Boom. On my own land, in my own terms. The reason we're doing it, and the reason across the board, is for facilitating the goal of health. It's generations of food inequality. Again, not necessarily native. Low-income people have food inequality and health issues regarding food. It doesn't matter what color you are, what country you came from, low-quality food will kill you. Diabetes, heart disease, hypertension, obesity, and addiction all can be related to the quality of the food you get. So that's why we got into this food sovereignty stuff. Can we go again? Oh, there we go. Okay. I hope it should be good from here on.
Yeah.
I don't think I had any other ones popping up. I don't know why it's not popping up. Different one. Where are we? The very tippity point of the state as far as you can go. My office sits 5 miles from Canada. Food. Well, to the north we have Canada, to the east and south we have the lake, and to the west we have the Superior National Forest and the BWCAW. All of our food comes through Duluth. And from Duluth, it came from a long way from there. Even our co-op, most of the food is sourced at least 100 miles away, because Duluth is over 100 miles away. So for us, food's a big deal. About 550 people coming and going on a regular rotating basis. You know, people come, people go, it sticks around 550. Not a lot of people, spread out over a good bit of acreage. A lot of the people also live in Grand Marais, so not everybody is actually in the village at all times. We have one convenience store / gas station. Depending on who's managing it, it can be a lot of good food, well, not a lot of good food, but it can be a little fresh food or not so much at all. For quite a while, until the last probably year and a half, the truck came on Thursday with the fresh vegetables, and if you wanted some, you needed to be first. Because if you waited till after work on Friday, you weren't going to get in. When I originally did a presentation for DHS, we had one cooler this wide with vegetables in it, and one cooler this wide with fresh fruits. That was it. We now have two coolers and a shelf. And the last manager was doing a pretty good job. He started getting fresh stuff brought in twice a week. So you could actually get fresh food on a regular basis. He had the whole cooler full of peppers and tomatoes and celery and salad and everything. So we've gotten better just in what we can get at the store. But it still has to come a long way. It's 34 miles to Grand Marais. We have two grocery stores and a co-op. Produce is fresh if you call 3 weeks on the road to get here fresh. And we have more of it. But a lot of our people don't have cars. Or don't have enough money to buy gas and groceries in the same week to go all the way to Grand Marais. 86 miles to the Zups in Silver Bay. Cheaper a little bit, but then you have to put in gas. 114 miles to the Super One in Two Harbors. And the nearest Cub Foods is the one right over here. That's the closest Cub Foods to where we are. If you really want good stuff that's fresh and a lot better, higher standard than what we have here, we could cross the border. Thunder Bay is 38 miles away, or 58 miles rather. There are 19 grocery stores and a superstore. And they have higher standards on their food than we do here in America. A lot of the stuff that we get down here, we don't like that pesticide. We don't like those chemicals in our food. So their standards are higher, the food is better, the food is fresher, because they actually have a lot of farming right up there. But again, you have to be able to cross the border to go get it.
Is that a hassle?
It's a hassle for a lot of people.
Don't you have to have a passport to cross that?
I have to have a passport. Tribal members only need their tribal ID card, but if you've had any DWI or any problems with the law,
they won't let you in.
So that part sometimes hangs people up. And you still have to have a card to get there, but yeah, it's technically, I have been told that your tribal ID card will get you across the border anywhere along the border into Canada. And if they tell you no, you tell them, I want to see your supervisor, because that card is supposed to give you guys free access. That's part of the treaty, is that free access back and forth across the border. Not everybody knows that, and certainly not all of the guards sitting there at the shack know that.
It's a good called chance to educate them. The J Treaty.
The J Treaty.
The J Treaty. Yeah. But the tribes were not a party to that treaty. It's the treaty between the United States and England.
Okay.
But... yeah,
but it's still supposed to work.
It's supposed to work.
There's an elder, I go to the Indigenous Farming Conference at White Earth every year, and there's an elder that comes down from Winnipeg. And she, every year, she says, every single time I go through that airport, I have to educate the bordermen that this, you know, check up the, you know, they're looking up Jay Treaty right there on the in the area, because that's what you need to do. So.
Did people carpool?
I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, they do.
They carpool so everybody can get groceries at the same time.
Very few of our folks do that up. Going down to Grand Marais, they do. Our elders bus, typically they take the elders up shopping, I think twice a month, and to Grand Marais twice a month. Maybe it's only one. It depends on the season too. But they go up quite a bit. They also go up in the summertime for berry picking. They go up all the time picking blueberries and strawberries up at the farms, because just north of the border, there's a lot of farming. It's beautiful, gorgeous farmland. So there's a lot of stuff available. I can't do it with my program because I'm federally funded. I can't spend federal funds in another country. So it would be nice to take our kids to a farm-to-school trip, but I'm not allowed. Geography. So, our challenges. Climate. We have 72 frost-free days a year. Look at your seed packet. Not very many things grow to maturity in 72 days. We have no soil. Our forest sits in about that much duff, and when you go to clear the land for a garden, you end up scraping that off, so you end up with a really nice, heavy, red clay. That's what we have for soil. Or rocks. That's what we have. it's a challenge. It's forested now. My understanding with some of the history I went and looked through is that there used to not be near so many trees. You could stand on the ramparts of the fort and look out and not see any trees. We'll talk about why that is, but it's forested now. There's a lot of them. The history is very long and convoluted. So if you're looking for traditional, we have to first decide what traditional means. Population, again, is pretty small. If you're going to have an agricultural process, sometimes you need a few people to help with that. We don't have a lot of people available. And we're extremely isolated. If we need soil, we need to truck it in. It's a long way to go when we get it. We come down here with the big dump truck, we get construction working on it, and we get WLSSD compost by the truckloads. A lot of coordination, it's kind of a pain. We're working on it.
How do you replenish the soil?
Compost, compost, compost.
And then WLSD.
Yeah, and we're working on our own composting. We're getting started, we're getting going. We're starting to get people aware of, get in the backyard, make a pile. So it's a process of, you know, of getting people to understand soil. Soil chemistry, soil needs, this, that, and the other, mix it together. That's what you have to do. That is our community garden plot. So that is the 90 by 90 school garden. This is the original community garden that went in. Actually, this is. And then they added another piece. These are three hoop houses that went in with an NRCS grant. This one out front just got cleared last year, and he planted it to cover crops to enrich the soil. And he will be planting this year. We'll get new plants there. These are some apple trees that the kids planted. These are apple trees that are well over 100 years old. This area is called Mineral Center. It actually was settled, I believe, in the 1930s. Big land rush, a lot of European descendants came up because minerals. They had found gold and silver and copper in trace amounts. So all of a sudden, all these people came to come and get the riches, as well as lumber. And they had a real nice town up there. They had resorts. And they put in a bunch of farms because, again, there was no real road, so they had to feed themselves. There was actually very nice truck farms growing and a lot of produce being trucked out to Grand Marais and Hovland and the surrounding towns. But then it forested back over again.
Is that where, I listened to the WTIP radio show in May 2016, and placed a garden where the traditional garden used to be, or garden used to be. That's one of the things I heard on the show. And is this where traditional garden?
Well, it was farmland. This, I believe it was the Carey farm. This one, this area right here was owned by a family named Carey.
What years are you talking?
In the 30s. So traditional, I wonder how far back.
Okay.
I do know of one, for sure, traditional one. It was out on Grand Portage Island, actually. But beyond that, I don't have that information.
Okay. Rick, one that's out on the island, how old?
We'll get to it here in a little bit.
Oh, okay.
I've got it on here.
Okay.
Because I did want to put some of the history up there. So, this is the space. The village is still way up there, or the falls rather, up there. That's where the Pigeon River will come in. The Pigeon River runs and forms the border. This is the Grand Portage, the great carrying place. That point, Raspberry Point, Grand Portage Island. This island actually had a 3-acre field that produced 200 to 250 bushels of potatoes a year.
Wow.
And it was used to feed these people. All of this trading that happened here, there were 1,000 to 1,500 people going through there every year, back and forth. It became pretty quickly to Grand Portage's best benefit to not do the trapping and the trading, but to be able to do the business. We are going to provide you the space to do your business, and we're going to feed you. So they were producing an awful lot of food to feed all of the European traders going through their port. This was a huge port. They make a big deal about Fort Snelling being the birthplace of Minnesota. Not even close, folks. Not even close. This is a long way to go, but it's actually, once you get up there and onto the Pigeon River, you can get all the way out west. best by portaging between lakes and streams, not a whole lot longer than that. And it's like 6.5 miles or 8.5 miles. Not a bad portage at all. I've walked it, at least part of it, most of it, and it's not a bad portage at all. So, let's see, my office sits right up about here, right on the bank overlooking. And then it's all trees. Everything's trees. All forested. We have very little open land now. So back in the day, they were doing things to control their environment.
Are those great decent are those decent rice lakes that I saw on the map? They're not?
Traditionally, they went up to Canada to get rice. They're bad rice lakes. Trustlands has worked a few times trying to get it in there and trying to get it going. They've had a lot of struggles doing it. Our water just isn't appropriate for wild rice. So they actually went up to Canada. In 1200, archaeological evidence places people in Grand Portage, at least passing through.
People.
It said Ojibwe in the literature I read. So. Not just native people, but Ojibwe native people. That's what I read. And I gave you the reference books over there because I'm only going by what I learned, not by what I know. They had that, and they were working there, and they were going through there for 400 years before we have evidence of Europeans. And it wasn't just these people. People were coming from far and wide. There's copper from Isle Royal that's in other parts of the world. It's across the country for sure. It's across, the northern continent. But it's in other parts of the world. So trade was a huge thing. And long before the Europeans jumped in, the native peoples were trading and they were going through Grand Portage because it is the way to get to the west. It's how you get there. So you can get to the Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific, the Gulf of Mexico, and Hudson's Bay, or the Arctic Ocean through the Grand Portage. That's a pretty important place. 1730 to 1805, that's where the port really had its heyday. And everything was going through Grand Portage. The emporium of goods and cultures is varied as any in the world. It was a huge, important port. The 1780s and 90s is when permanence came. So prior to that, people would come in for this season and that season. The people of Grand Portage traveled around quite a bit. They were up in Rady Lake. They were up in Canada Rising. This was a great place to fish in the fall to get your fish and smoke it up and get ready for provisions for winter. It became permanent because, again, the business. They needed to feed all of these people coming through. It was a great business to be in, to provide for those people at the fort. The fort subsisted principally on pork and hominy. Pork and hominy? They had corn in Grand Portage. Butter, peas, corn, potatoes, tea, and wine. They had a herd of cows. In 1783, they had a herd of cows that was providing all of the milk they needed for all of the people coming and going and staying at that fort. The comprehension of that time period, the business of food that was going on, and, as well as the fisheries. In the 1839, some of the fur was kind of lower, and the guys started to, hey, we got fish. They were smoking them, they were packing them, and they started trading the fish as well. So it was pretty awesome. And by 1860, they had as much as 3,000 bushels of potatoes in a year. So that little island had a 3-acre field, but they had to have had fields all over. They had to have. And so if there were that many people going through there every year, there weren't any trees. Everybody needed firewood, construction material. They had wiped out the forest as far as the eye could see. So when the man stood on the ramparts of the fort, it was a long way to go for firewood. I'm guessing Grand Portage provided firewood, meat, and fish, and vegetables, and that was their primary business.
Potatoes. Fire, soil. So there was soil there.
They'll grow in clay.
They will?
They will grow. It's amazing that the area I live in now, I'm quite a bit down, I'm just outside of Grand Marais, up on a big hill. Mm-hmm. 23 feet of clay when they dug the well. That whole area, however, they used to have phenomenal potato fields up there.
Oh, gosh.
And maybe part of it was the nutritional value of that duff But yeah, you mix it up a little bit and those potatoes will push through that clay and they actually break it up. So at a certain point, it becomes tillable soil.
Is this a particular kind of potato?
I wish I knew. I wish I knew, because I'd be grabbing them left, right, and center.
Yeah, really.
I know some of them don't do so well at all. Some of them do very well. The big key that we're finding is drainage. How wet a year is it? We've had great potato years, and we've had rotting in the ground potato years. So there was a lot of food produced. We know this. Not anymore. So commercial fishing has always been up there. There was a time in Grand Portage where the local fishermen were supplying the restaurant, and there was an awesome woman down there at the restaurant that knew exactly what to do with whose fish, and she had standards. And the boys knew that the fish you brought to her was the best fish that you could bring to her, and they had a great relationship and it worked well. She's not there anymore. Of course, she got old enough to say, I'm done with this working stuff, and it became necessary for our fishermen to find other ways to get rid of their food. So they've been working with the trucks that go up and down the shore. They've been working a lot through Shelley Tofty, the fish market in Grand Marais. Fish from Grand Portage, and particularly the herring roe, goes all over the world through Grand Marais. They have a very good market, and they do very well. Their fish is expensive, because they've got a very good market, and it's hard to get it in Grand Marais because a lot of our people can't, or Grand Portage rather, a lot of our people can't afford to pay them the price they can get by shipping it down. So we're working, or at least we had dreams of working with our guys to try to figure out a way to improve their market locally. It just wasn't something we've been able to do yet, but we do have a few more people knowing who to call if you need something, and the guys are working with them a little more, so there is more of our fish being eaten in our community, but that's a work in progress. Again, they have a good market, and fish populations, how much can they have that they need to get to the good guys so they can make the money they need to make to keep their business going.
Are those fishermen mostly band members or not?
We have, as far as I know, all of the ones in Grand Portage are band members and have their cards. As they age and retire out, those licenses, I'm not sure, are getting picked up by the next generation. You only get a certain number for the fishery, and I don't know how many we have left. I know there's still guys out fishing. As I was coming down the other day, I saw one of the guys heading out. It's like, well, he's heading out, he's spring, and he's...
But wouldn't they be fishing under the treaty rights?
Yeah, that's the one. One aspect of the agreement with the state that there's X amount of commercial fishing down under the treaty waters, just outside Grand Portage. I don't remember how many though.
It's not so much about you can't do that, it's about if we want to maintain this fishery,
right,
we can't overfish it.
And it's managed
so
through the
band. It's
band.
Managed, and the band does an awful lot of managing. Our elders pretty much have fish every Friday, and most of it comes from the trust lands guys out there that are doing their netting and they're doing their population studies and all of that. They're bringing fish into the elders on a regular basis. But yeah, commercially, it's a delicate watershed, and we have to be careful. In 93, they actually started to think really seriously about gardening. There was an extension program called Project Grow. And this Rick Anderson I mentioned earlier, he was a big roller with that. Let's get some gardens, let's go. The biggest expense from the grant they got was soil. They started making small family plots, and they had a really nice plot in front of the community center. They trucked in an awful lot of soil to build them. That top picture right there is right in front of our community center. They have this really nice little fenced-in garden. It's now a lawn that barely grows grass. That tree is still there. There's a little tree right here. That tree is still there. Not really a whole lot bigger. Soil underneath the garden wasn't really good, and topsoil didn't quite work. But, it was a great project for about a year and a half, but then activity, people, manpower, it kind of fell to the wayside. A lot of the family plots that were created in that, though, still get gardened by the families that have them. In 2009, there was movement at Trust Lands. The guys finally got excited about it, and they cleared that 100-year-old farm I was pointing at, They started with that first plot in 2009. And Rick Anderson was the first guy in there to stake out his piece. One of our new master gardeners was among the second families in there to stake out their piece. It has been gardened since 2009, actively. They added the second set of plots, I believe, 2 years or 3 years later. And at one time, it was all full. And then when I started, there were five people. I think there's 12 plots altogether. And there were five families that were farming it when I started in 2012. So there was a lot of excitement for a little while, and then again, it waned. Or families moved away and nobody picked up the plots. In 2012, in the fall, they cleared area. So this is the community garden here. On the other side of this, all these trees, that's where they cleared for the school garden. Kids were picking the rocks out. They added quite a bit of compost and soil and sawdust and other things, and the truss lands, or the construction guys tilled it and 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 chopped it and tilled it, and you still find great big chunks of clay when you're trying to plant your rose. But it's, after, you know, the years we've been in it, it's actually doing pretty good. It's pretty good soil now. It's still heavy, so it's still hard to get it to dry out, but being creative, we make nice mounded rows and we do all right. The next year, the NRCS program had a hoop house grant. You buy the hoop house, you get it built, and you get it planted, and we'll reimburse you for almost all of the cost of the hoop house. So Andy Schmidt, our ag coordinator, who at the time was just a biologist with Trust Lens, who liked gardening, he got the hoop houses in and got them built. And then 2013 also was the first year we got the school gardening going crazy. I got in with the kids and we just started getting goofy. We had a garden, the greenhouse that had been bought 3 or 4 years earlier that had been in a box. And nobody ever put it together. So that spring, 2013, we got them out, got the construction guys out there, put it together. We had kids in there potting and planting. It was a fabulous outdoor classroom. We got the kids up to the garden, brand new garden. The boys got the fence up, and they were out there planting. We had planters in front of the community center and school. They're 3 foot wide. They're about 2 feet high. I think it's 97 feet on the school side and 113 feet on the community center side. And that, I believe, was part of the Project Grow also. They filled that with dirt so it could be planted. Mostly it was flowers. We started planting vegetables there. Each classroom, we have K1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. Each classroom got a 10-foot or so section, and that was their classroom's garden. 30 square feet for the kids, and they picked what was in there, and it was up to them to figure out planting, get it planted. They had grow labs in the classrooms, so we got those back into working, and we got going crazy. Harvest! Happy kids! Shortly after this picture was taken, the little guy with the squash tripped. Fell, scratched up the squash. Oh, I broke it. Can we eat it? Guess who whipped out her pocket knife in a real big hurry? I had kids chasing me around the playground because they thought it was the best thing they ever ate, and they wanted pieces of squash. So they eat it. If they grow it, they'll try it. I also started this Garden in a Box program. I partnered with Minnesota State Horticultural Society, Garden in a Box program. You get this plastic 4x3 box and all of the dirt to go in it and a whole set of plants to start. And it's a 3-year process. So the first year you get everything. The second year you just get the plants. And the third year you're expected to plant it yourself and report how it went. Our third year was last year and everybody did plant their gardens. A couple of families weren't the same families that started the program, but everybody did plant their gardens. And I actually added 3 more gardens to the program, and they got in too late last year to get planted, but the young man has already started seeds in his house for his and his family ones, and the elder, that he's got the elders in his yard because it's closer and easier for him to work it, and then she'll just come down for a walk. But she's got seeds starting in her house, so... It worked. It worked really, really well. So that's our recent history. All of this happened before we had a food sovereignty project. So there was a lot of stuff going on, and finally somebody said, hey, maybe we should have a meeting. So Andy Schmidt was a biologist at Trust Lands who liked to garden, and he was key to the community garden site. Bobby is our construction manager. Marcia, solid waste specialist, waste reduction and composting. Rick Anderson, been in gardening forever, therapist. Project Grow, he was the head of that committee. Myself, nutrition educator, farm to school, garden in a box. The health director, health services, and the wellness committee. NPS, a gardener and a beekeeper. Daycare cook. Glendon leadership training. I love that thing. That is awesome. The school principal and cultural educator. All of us were doing something. I was working with the principal and the educator. He's one of the guys that actually showed me my first wild foods. We're doing summer camp, and he says, oh, we're going on a berry hike. From our school to the top of Mount Rose, there were thimbleberries, raspberries, blueberries, gooseberries, juneberries, currants, and wintergreen. And it's all of a mile from the school to the top of the mountain. All of that food is growing wild right out there. And there were kids in that summer camp that picked berries all the way along, had their little cup full of berries. And when I asked one of the young men, how come you haven't eaten them all? We get our berries at the store. On two separate instances in my career there, I've had to teach children that those were edible, that they could go in the woods and find food. They simply didn't know that those were edible, that those were safe to eat. It didn't come from the store, it's not safe to eat. So we had all kinds of stuff, and finally, you know, it was like, I was talking to Paula about something with the garden, and she said, well, why don't you talk to Rick? He would know. And then I talked to Rick, and he says, oh yeah, yeah, talk to Andy, he would know. And we finally thought, yeah, maybe we should sit down as a group. So we did. And we got to talking, and why are you doing this? Why are you doing that? Why are you? This was what? Food is health. Quite simple. We knew for our community that access was important to clean, healthy food. We knew that we were lacking a lot of skills, knowledge, and opportunity. So you need all of that to be able to grow, gather, hunt, and fish in sustainable ways. And we needed to figure out a distribution system that was fair to everybody. All of us in the group agreed. Awesome. We now have a committee for food sovereignty. So we sat down and said, okay, this is for real. We got to do this now. Mission statement, analysis, plan, not your traditional things, however, necessary if you're going to get six people to sit in a room and then go out and do and not cross-do and overdo. So the first thing, the reason, new and advanced, to create new and advance existing local systems for access to and production of food, culturally appropriate, environmentally responsible, the overall goal of improving community health. You know, the exercise thing is key for health, but if you're gardening, exercise is already there. Fresh air is already there. So the gardening and the food kind of was the first jumping off point to getting this improved health. The big key in the community is find out what's happening. You know, as we're sitting at the table, not all of those people were the first group to meet, but they were the first, hey, she's doing this and she knows, so we started pulling people in. Oh, so-and-so's got a garden, let's bring them in, bring them in. Finding out what you already have and what's already happening. You know, if you have a program that's awesome, but you want to branch out, finding somebody else that's doing it so you don't have to start over and make it up yourself. Hey, they already know how to do that. Let's work together. Doing a strategic plan. How many communities spend thousands of dollars doing a strategic plan and they've got a nice binder and they put it on the shelf and never look again? Ours is not. This is a living document. Every year we do a meeting with our community. This is what we did last year. What do you want us to work on next year? These are the things we tried this year. This one worked good, that one not so much. What are we going to do this year? And it's a living, breathing thing. It changes. Again, when we talked about our fish producers, that was big in our plan at the beginning. It's really a hard nut to crack, so we moved on to other things. We did a survey for the producers. Everybody who's producing food, we just sent out a survey to put it through the community. Who's producing what? What do you need? What do you want? What can we do for you? How can we help you? Do you want to have your name put out here so people can find you and buy your food? We asked the community. We did the same with people who eat food. We said, hey, what do you want to eat? What can we help with? What do you think needs to be changed or different or better? We got a lot of information. One of the cool ones, everybody wanted raspberries. From my office, if I walk to the end of the parking lot, there are raspberries way along the parking lot. Everybody wants raspberries. All you have to do is go outside and pick them. Andy has taken it as a personal mission to never have to plant a raspberry plant in Grand Portage because they're everywhere. No, they can go get their own. But what do they want? It doesn't make a darn bit of difference if we plant 4,000 barrels of potatoes if nobody's going to eat potatoes. Ask your community, ask. Let them tell you what they want. Then we had this, again, the committee, the Food Sovereignty Assessment Assistance. Nobody knew what our name was. All of us on the committee didn't know what our name was. People asked us and we couldn't know what to tell them. We were on the radio. We didn't know what to tell them. We put it to our group. We put it to the community. Hey, what should we call this? This is what we got. Community agriculture through culture, health, and education. True to our purpose, true to our mission, true to our original goal, and culturally accurate for where we are. So that's one of the community members. Your auntie, as a matter of fact, came up with this. Oh. The sign, however, was one of the other committee members' father, who he's kind of artistic. And he said, you know, we need some kind of a sign for our farmer's market and to let people know when we're just, I don't know, just make something. That's what he came up with. And underneath it is a nice basket of food, all beautifully painted. So we have a little sandwich board we can put up to let people know what we're doing. Tell the story, tell the story, tell the story, tell the story. Talk. I can go sit with the elders and have lunch and say one thing about the garden. And if you sit there long enough, they start telling you and talking and asking. You say one thing and then listen. And you hear and learn so much more. Northern Wilds Magazine has been out a couple of times to talk to us about our gardens up there. This young man here actually does gardening, and he's the first beekeeper in Grand Portage. Him and his wife keep bees as well.
Is it Travis?
Travis Stavitsky, yeah. Travis and Jessica. Gardening in our moccasin. This is our community paper. We try to have stuff in there every month about what's happening with our food for thoughts. We're on the radio. I've been on the radio 3, 4, 5, 6 times for different programs. Northern Gardening, I think I've been on 3 times. Rick's been on there 6 times. And the cultural part, we just keep people ask questions, and all of a sudden somebody's there with a camera or a microphone. Talk about it. We had actually PBS come up, or want to come up. How they heard, I don't know, but they did. So talk about it. That's why we needed a name, because everybody was listening and talking and asking questions. The biggest way to get more people involved in your project is to talk about it. Because then they tell 2 people, and they tell 2 people, and they tell 2 people. We're not so good with the social media stuff yet. We Moccasin Telegraph a lot better. Food for Thought is one of the first things we did. We're doing this. We have a committee. Great. How are we going to let everybody know? And that knowledge gap was such a big deal. We started a monthly community education program focused on food. The first one was alphabet soup. We sat down and thought, you know, the first thing we need to do is have everybody understand what we're talking about. What does organic mean? What is GMO? What is pesticide, herbicide? What's the difference? So that was the first one. Hey, this is what we're talking about. This is soil. This is what's important about soil, what you need to know and understand. We had, I believe it was 27 people showed up that first night. Now, in a population of 550, it's not a bad average. It's not a bad percentage. And our average is 23 a month. So in a year, in 11 different ones, our average is still 23 a month. Pretty good. Our topics run the gamut. And every year, again, they have cards on the table. What do you want to learn? What do you want to learn? We take all the cards. We sort them through. We put them down on the list. And the ones that had the most votes We plug them into a yearly calendar, and that becomes the topics for food for thought for that year. We're in our third year, and it's very successful. It's working very well. We started off the first year with those of us on the committee, the experts, doing all of the teaching. It didn't take until like the third or fourth one where we started finding community members that knew stuff. Hey, I heard you make jam and jelly. Would you be willing to come and teach? Well, sure, I can. She's been here three times teaching three different skills now. She's a very popular person, and she has people coming up to her at ENP or at lunch and saying, that salsa thing, could I just come over when you're doing that and learn how? Supporting the knowledge that's already there. Let the people in the community be the experts. That's probably the awesomest thing. We did this making sausage with a fella in the community down the road in Holland who'd actually learned everything he knew from one of the community members in Grand Portage who was too shy to tell us about it. So he sat at the front table, and the guy that was doing the teaching, who was kind of nervous too, but he'd say something and then he'd look over at Gene, and Gene would nod and say he knew he had it right. So the elder was teaching through his own little puppet. It works really well, supporting that knowledge. The light supper. We actually have this light supper every time. We try very hard to have local or traditional foods or both, as we define it. The food is kind of why most people come. It's getting to be. The topics change. We have a core group of people that come every time because they know they're going to learn something, and they know the food's going to be awesome. And the chance to sit and talk and the fellowship that goes on. You know, one of the nurses, she's never been really interested in food, but she started coming, and she says, I come every time. I can't believe how much I learn. We have another gal that's blaming us for gaining weight. So, sausage making. We had a lot of guys that time. I think we had like 33 or 32 or 33 people come that night, and most of them were guys, because they all were interested in sausage making. And they heard that the Elder Gene was going to be the one that whose recipes were going to be up there. This one here was the most fun we ever had. Andy came in from the garden with all these beautiful cabbage, and we made sauerkraut. And this was the kickoff to gardening one spring. So this is Andy, our ag coordinator. These two ladies are master gardeners from Grand Marais. This one is also a beekeeper. So we're involving the knowledgeable people in the community and all kinds of different topics. This I thought might be fun, but yes, it has an extension. Do you want the player to try to play this content? Yes. Yes. Okay. It's not going to work.
I'm sorry.
I had a really cool video. It worked. It worked on my laptop. It's not going to work.
Let me try it.
Unless this is a different version, I think, than the one on my computer. It's a nice little, like, 3-minute video clip of everybody pounding cabbage. When I had it on mine, there was a little bar at the bottom. You just hit play and it would go. But I don't see the bar. Oh, there we go. Right in there, so it's embedded in the.
Okay.
It's embedded in there, but it must be the wrong pile of time. It was fun. All right, make it slideshow.
Are they doing the sauerkraut?
They're doing the sauerkraut. So basically, Emma just brought all of these little blue buckets, and there was a whole table full of ladies chopping, and then we'd fill the buckets and add the salt, and they were just pounding and pounding. Eric is the one that made all the sticks.
Oh, cool.
Nice rounded sticks, and we had the whole group of people pounding and smashing and. Macerating the cabbage, and then we put it in a beautiful German crock, and we had it in our office until the next month. It was fermenting, and every once in a while it would bubble and let it rattle, and it smelled really interesting. The next month's dinner was the sauerkraut we'd made at the month before.
Oh, how cool.
Locally produced, locally made, it was
nice.
A lot of fun. Local food, traditional food, how do we know? We've had people coming and going through that land since 1200. How many of the plants that are growing there were there before 1200? How in the world will we ever know? The seeds that were getting traded, the everything, the food that came through, we don't know what's traditional. How far back do you want to go? So we do have cedar tea and Labrador tea. We know through story that those have been around forever. We do them, we brought them back, we have them. Actually, I was not at a couple of Food for Thoughts. I had to be out of town. And I got back and Mary came up to me and she said, "You can't be gone anymore." They really missed their cedar tea. So I taught a few other people to make it. Now if I'm gone, they can make it too. It's very important. We do a lot of venison. Trust lands also, we get a lot of venison from. We've had moose also from trust lands. Rick's favorite thing to do is go get rabbit. He goes up to Canada, buys his rabbit, comes back, and then just hands us a receipt. It's not federal money going up there. Shh, quiet. We get rabbit. We have had bison, lots of Lake Superior fish. We also do a lot of grilling of the fish on the grill in the summertime. It's so awesome. Tons of fresh produce comes in from Andy, our ag producer. And we make every point possible to always have a big green salad with our meals. And then what we can't get, we get from the co-op, which is also supporting local farmers, as local as we can get anyway. And there's an awful lot of people in Grand Marais now that are starting to farm at levels that the food is getting to the co-op and getting out to the community. So we're doing our best to support local food and as traditional as we know how to make it. Distribution. So Andy went from being that biologist over at Trust Lands, the statewide health improvement program grant came out, and we used part of that and part of my SNAP education dollars to hire Andy as an ag coordinator. He is now the man that's out there growing the food on a large scale basis. We get the kids out to plant the school garden. They're not in school all summer. We have a summer camp that the council has made a point of trying to say, it's not for learning, it's for fun. So less of the classroom, more of the entertaining part of things. They do go up to the garden, but mostly we garden in front of the community center and the planters, not at the big garden. So Andy gets stuck with a lot of the care and maintenance over the summertime. We have a mentorship program where Andy and I both end up with kids, 13, 14-year-old kids, following us around, and they get to do a lot of the summer gardening. So we get as many people up there as we can and educate as much as we can, but he does a lot of the work. When he has produce coming in, when the school kids aren't there, that produce goes into our programs. Daycare program. He takes his truck full of produce and drives on over, and that cook gets to come out and go shopping in the back of his truck. The daycare program, the Head Start program when they're in session, although their rules make it really hard for them to get too much in. Oshkeogamog's charter school, and also the summer food program, and then the elderly nutrition program. That project Grow in 93, one of the things they did was build a greenhouse for the elders and put up some planters so they have their own. They have not always had somebody to tend that garden. So they were very happy to have Andy come in and really bring lots and lots of produce. I garden and I get some stuff. Andy's amazing. He's producing 1,300, 2,000, 3,000 pounds of food. And he's getting it out to the people who need it. At this point, we're not charging for any of the produce we produce. Because if my program, federally funded, buys seeds, I can't charge money for anything that comes off of those seeds. So it's free.
Are you limited to the seeds you pick?
The money we get comes from federal grants or state grants or whatever. So you can't take states funded seeds and then sell the produce. You can certainly donate it to all the programs.
But the variety of...
We pick whatever varieties we want. I started off going for Seed Savers Exchange just because they're fairly good and they save the stories, and they do have cultural seeds, native cultural seeds in their seed banks. Andy really likes Fedco because they're appropriate to the temperate zone in which we're gardening. We also have been working with White Earth and getting some of the seeds that are traditional. We've been trying to grow Bear Island corn We have not. We had one good successful year. I actually got a lot of corn that made it all the way through despite the cornworms. But it's, we just, we're not there yet to be producing and making seed for our own. Some of the stuff, we've got a flambeau bean that's been very good for us, and we've saved that and are replanting our own seed. Okay, so we're getting there.
Okay, flambeau corn, or flambeau bean, and the Bear Island corn. How old are those?
The flambeau came from, was it Seed Savers, I believe?
Oh.
And that had an old story to it. The Bear Island Chippewa corn came out of Leech Lake, the Bear Island out there in Leech Lake. Zach Page at White Earth has been growing it. There's also a young man up in Finland who is doing a phenomenal job growing it in Finland. And those two guys have been exchanging seed. Margaret Plummerstein at the National Park Service has a small, the small kitchen garden there, and then a small traditional garden inside the fort, and she's been growing it. So we started, I started getting seed, bringing seed to her from them, and they're trying to get the genetics going so that we have a large enough sample size to get really good genetics. And Zachary's doing very well with his, and again,
is that a hominy corn?
It's flint corn. It makes really good corn soup. As we did at Sugar Camp last year, we actually did make hominy out of ours and make good corn soup, and it's very tasty. So it works well for that too, but it is a flint corn. It's a shorter corn that actually will produce really nice ears if it's having a really good year, and it does very well. So we're doing our best at this point, but we all have regular jobs, and we just don't have enough time to really get into the seed saving. I'm hoping with our two new master gardeners that I can encourage one of them who's already done some seed saving of their own to do more of that on a large scale community basis. Excuse me. We have a couple of elders that have plants and seeds and things that I've shared a little bit. There's some rhubarb that's going around and some of the herbs. I just haven't had a lot of people coming in saying, this is my grandmother's seed. We don't seem to have that seed saver up there other than Margaret. And Margaret's very, she's got her own stuff that she's doing, and she doesn't have a large scale quantity to do a whole lot more. And we don't have a place to grow it out yet. We're producing food, we don't have a place to be producing seed. And they are two very different things. Especially for the stuff that crosses like corn, which is kind of hard, very hard. But we're making lots of food. What's left out after he goes to the programs goes to a farm market. Puts it out on the picnic table in front of the clinic. We decided we didn't want it at the trading post where all of the tourists were going by. This is for the community. So it's up in the middle of the community, in front of the clinic, and across from the school and community center. 20 to 25 families a week are coming in. We've had a couple of gardeners in town that if they have extra, they will come and put it on the table as well. And we do not charge for it. We have a donation can. So if you have plenty and you think that tomato is worth $5, thank you very much. If you don't have any, thank you very much. Take what you need. Some of the families, you know, you come, the mother, and she's got one on her back and two strolling along beside, and they're walking all the way up there. And those kids are looking at these beautiful colors and just, can I try this? Can I try it? And the kids get that bean and they're holding onto it like it's precious gold. That is the best picture in the world. They have those kids shopping for what they want to eat. And there are almost never any leftovers. He came in with 3 tubs of beans one day. He had warned me. He had 3 tubs of beans. The beans just went crazy. I made parsley pesto, because he also had tons of parsley. So we had a little tasting station up there. Hey, you like those beans here? Try this. People were eating parsley pesto, because we had all of the ingredients for that, too, more or less. So part of the other problem is beautiful produce. What do I do with it? We don't have a lot of leftovers. We had some beans that time. We also have the village orchard. You guys are familiar with that boat that was stranded out here in the harbor for a long time. Was it 3 years ago? And they did bad things, and they got fined. And that fine went into a pot. And somehow, somebody said, guys, I'd like to write a grant for you on our behalf. And we got a big bunch of money for fruiting trees, shrubs, and plants. And so last year, Andy was a goofy fool planting a lot of trees. He went crazy. We have over 100 trees on this hillside. And this is a nice hillside that was a natural gravel pit for a long time. And then when they went to dig out the holes for the water treatment plant, all of that nice swamp dirt they brought up here on this hill and filled in where they've taken all the gravel out. So there's really good soil in there, if you don't mind the rocks. The fence was hard to put up. Andy had trouble with rocks. But there's over 100 trees, and they are apple, cherry, plum, pear, grape, and apricot. No raspberries. The entire field is kind of ringed with raspberries already. But he's got it all in there, he's got it all fenced, and so far the animals are really kind of leaving it alone.
The grapes are growing? I'm sorry.
The grape, they've been planted, and so far so good. And they are ones that Rick Anderson up at the community garden has had grapevines up there now for 5 or 6 years. And they do grow and they do produce fruit. They're table grapes. And he loves them. I don't. Rick says he has a bed and breakfast, and he says he has done stuffed grape leaves. I've not seen, heard, or tasted them, so I do.
Okay. It's great fiber. But do you know what he puts in them?
No idea. I just know he's growing grapes, and he gets just goofy when he gets a bunch. He gets so excited, and he's made jam out of them that he then serves his clients at his bed and breakfast, and he gets rave reviews. I don't know what kind. I've not tasted them. He doesn't share.
Are you allowed to tell us the name so I can?
I don't know. Okay. You want to write down your contact information, and I will try to get it from him and email it to you.
Okay.
I'd be happy to do that if he's willing to share. And I know, like I said, Andy's gotten a bunch too, so I'm assuming that they're the same kind because he knew they grew there.
Yeah. Okay.
One of the things that came apart as a part of this is we got the legacy grant from the whole football thing to build a new playground. Once that's finished off, the fence line and the area around that will also be planted to fruiting trees and grapevines on the fence and stuff. And then this year there's a whole bunch of strawberry plants. Strawberry fields going to be going. So we'll have our pick your own ever-bearing strawberries throughout the summer as well. So it was good timing. Then there's the bison program, and it's finally off the ground. This is kind of a things change slowly in Indian country story. And if you're doing something and you don't feel like you're going fast enough, take a breath. Look back at where you started and realize how far you've come and just keep walking along. Andy had this idea in 2009. And he brought it to the one manager, and he said, yeah, okay, bring it to the other one. 2009, they started with the idea, and they started throwing it around and tinkering with it, and they're busy people doing other things. 2011 and 14, they actually officially started looking at parameters. You know, they knew enough now to start saying, okay, can we really do this? Where could we do it? How could we do it? Do we have what we need? Would they even survive here? 2015, and NRCS again, good bunch of people for us. They actually sat down with the guys and said, okay, this is what you need to be able to do to have a grazing rotation, to have a grazing plan. 2016, we got the BIA grant. They were trying to give away bison like crazy that year. At all of the food sovereignty conferences, the farming conference I went to, the guy was running around. You guys need. So we got the grant in 2016 and got excited. Then the land use permit. So he had to choose three different sites and have an idea of and a plan sort of for each of the three different sites. And then it had to go through archaeology and field assessment and trust lands assessment, and everything had to be assessed and checked and scientific and studied. And then it goes to land use, and the land use guys look at it, and of course they know what traditional here, and that's the trail to so-and-so, and that's this was homestead, and they finally said, yes, this plot, go for it, here's your permit. This spring, they started clearing trees, and they're pretty well getting close to being done with the trees, and the request for bids has gone out for who wants to build the fence. And we're really going to do it.
What size ear are you talking about?
I don't know.
What kind of bison? Which kind?
I don't know. Andy's the man on all of that, and the details. I didn't get to go to his meeting that told us all of this stuff. Okay. So I don't have that information. Again, write it down, and I can write the questions, and I can do my best to get the answers.
So then you have no idea how many is going to go into that area.
Right now, his current plan, we're talking 12 to 16 to start with, because this is all forest. Okay. This is a grazing rotation.
Right.
We have to start growing something for them to eat.
So it's got to be a good-sized area if it's going to house that many.
Right. And that's, you know, you've got to get going. You've got to have grass here and grass here so that when they're done, you can move them.
And you have to be able to get them from point A to point B without destruction.
Yep. And there is a fella down southern, can't remember the town. He does Galloway cattle on a grazing rotation. He's got, you know, this whole acreage this way. So they go from this pen to this pen. And then from this pen to this pen. And they just keep going and then turn around and come all the way back. That's how he feeds his cattle. That's how he's making his living as an organic farmer. And it's amazing. He doesn't handle them.
Right.
But when he goes to that gate, every head turns. And they wait. Yeah, and he opens the gate, pushes it open. Then he steps back. The minute he steps back, there's food over there. They know that. And easy as pie, his cattle
and
are wonderful people.
Well, with the bison and stuff, well, you can't have just like a regular fence because they'll just go right through that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the one that was out by us way out there, I think they were like cable or something, high voltage.
And the biggest thing is they will eat food. They move for food. As long as you're grazing is what they need, they have no reason to go anywhere. If they're surrounded by woods that have no food in it, they have no reason to go anywhere. Andy's been up across the border, up by Kekabeka Falls. There is a bison farm, and he spent some time up there with that fella, and that fella has on board as a help, give me a call, whatever you need. He's very much saying, yes, I would love to help you do this. So we've got an expert on the ground for Andy to work with. But 9 years it took to get the project going. And lots of meetings with the community and lots of informational gatherings and lots of permission and lots of input from the community. So the ship rolled. That's Andy. He moved from Trust Lands. He's now the ag coordinator. He runs the hoop houses. He does the community garden. He's kind of the coordinator and overseer. Each community member is responsible for their plot. And the tools are there. Andy doesn't do it anymore. It's up to them to take care of it and do their own. He's busy with other things. So it's requiring people to step up and do the work and take ownership of that process. He does the farmer's market. He does the distribution. He's doing the community orchard. He works in the school garden when we bring the kids up there, but we coordinate it. He's just there to, hey, this is what we're doing. This is where we're doing it, and show the kids how and get it done. He's part of this food for thought process, our monthly meetings. He's a big part of that, especially producing the food for it. But he does a lot of teaching there, especially with the soil and the plant management and what to start and when to start it and what it's supposed to look like and diseases and pests. And he will be the head man on the bison program. How many hours a day do you think this is going to take him? One thing we really don't have, remember I mentioned that population, we need some more manpower. We need some more people. And then my role, food for thought events. That's all my equipment. Most of the time when bringing anything in, I provide all of the equipment, the supplies. I do the shopping for everybody. And we work as a group to make the plans as far as who's doing what. The Garden in a Box program, I'm still actively working with and making sure those are active and people are getting what they need. I actually created a little booklet, a first-time gardener booklet. So look in your book. And if it's not in the book, then call me. And working really to coordinate and connect those people so instead of calling me, they call each other and starting to share that knowledge again. I coordinate with the school garden. I started off doing it all myself. And one of the school helpers over there was interested and wanted to start learning, but had never really planted seeds and never really been able to grow houseplants. She started working with this. She would coordinate the classroom and say, this is what we want to do. I would come over and say, okay, here's all we need to do it. We do it. Now she has gone from not knowing how to plant a seed. She became a master gardener last year, and she's now the cultural coordinator at school and pretty much the head. And she just tells me what she needs, and I bring in the stuff, as opposed to me having to run the program. She's doing more and more and more of it. Bringing recipes to the farmer's market. Andy, what do you have a lot of? Okay, let's have some turnip recipes. Let's have some pesto. Let's have some, so people know what to do with it. Cooking in the classroom and beyond. Cooking skills are a huge, huge thing that we've lost up there. A lot of people don't have a clue how to cook. Everything's coming out of the boxes. Food distribution, you get all your parts and you go home. We're having to do a lot of teaching and basic cooking skills. The kids love it. We did peas when you're in the garden. We have climbing peas all around the fences. And the teacher said, you know, it's great that they go out to the garden and all, but I really wish they really understood the whole process. We harvested peas. Then we brought them back to the classroom. And they put the circle of chairs, and they said, okay, we're going to learn to shuck peas. You ever remember doing that with your grandmother on the porch? It was amazing. I put three kids in there to start with. And I went over here to teach these kids the part they were going to do. And I turned around and there were six people over there. People were coming in out of the hallway. It is that social piece, that tactile social thing of sitting there shucking peas. The principal even came out of the office and all of a sudden she was sitting there shucking peas. They learned to shuck them, cook them. They made a nice little peas and mint dish. They also were blanching and packing for freezing. So they did the whole process. They planted and started them in the spring. They harvested, they shucked. They did all of the work and had a fabulous little dish of minted peas for their afternoon snack that day. All the way through the process, we do our best. These kids here are having a blast. We had a ton of onions that year, and I had the nice net bags. They'll put it on the scale, and they get to 6 pounds. And they spent all afternoon, a really icky, crappy, nasty day out in the outdoor classroom with the greenhouse, having a blast. Then they brought them all in to their cook, and they hung them on the shelf in her kitchen storage area, and she was using those to feed the kids all winter long, which was a fabulous thing for those kids to know when they went in there. Miss Jean, is my onion in there? Yep, your onion's in there. We do... Even the little ones, these were the K-1ers out there picking carrots. They had a ball. They just sat in that patch and picked carrots pretty much for an hour and a half. They got all the way through to the middle pretty good. We came in, this one we brought in all of the roots because it had gotten cold on us. Everything's just about, oop, it's freezing. Brought everything in and they were doing the scrubbing and the cleaning. We had some potatoes that were starting to freeze and rot. It was a perfect opportunity to whip out the plastic knives, and we started to learn cutting skills. Here's your knife skills. Here's how you do this. And they chopped and they chopped. A couple of the kids were having a tough day. They found a real zen moment in the chopping and the cutting and that skill and that kitchen. And then we ended up making a squash potato corn bean, casserole, more or less, I guess, sauté. Corns, beans, squash, in there. And they had a ball. Some of them liked the cooking part, some of them liked the chopping part, some of them were just happy over there scrubbing like crazy. They all got to do something fun and it was the stuff they grew. After that, we had a pretty good harvest that year, and as their community service project, the kids decided that they should share that produce. So they had a food day and invited the whole community in for a little meal and to take what they needed. So they actually gave away all their produce, which was a pretty awesome thing for a bunch of kids to decide to do. This little guy was in summer camp. We're making scissor salsa. It's a scavenger hunt. I have little cards, hand them all out, go find your ingredients. If they find the tomato plant, somebody would hand them some cherry tomatoes because of course our tomatoes weren't done yet. They got all their ingredients. Onion grass is one of their favorites. Chives. They will drive by on their bike and grab a handful of chives, and they'll be walking around, chives hanging out of their mouth. They love onion grass. Then we take it out to the picnic table in front of the community center, and choppers and pounders and mortar and pestles, and they make salsa. And we sit out on the ground and eat it, and they have a wonderful, awesome day. Two kids in one family have decided to become cooks. They liked the scissor salsa, and they liked the smoothies. We made kale apple smoothies and a kale sauté out on the picnic tables in front of the community center. They thought that was pretty cool. One of them has a really impressive apron collection now. He's collecting aprons. The other one's collecting measuring cup sets. So, big boys, too. They play hockey. They love cooking. They're having a ball. That's my biggest thing, is the cooking skills, because that's what we really need. Along the way for this process, the community is a part of it all the time. They're the ins, the outs, the ups, the downs. They're leading it. Every year, at the end of the year, we come back and say, okay, this is what we did. Here's all the numbers. Here's the attendance. Here's the topics. What do you want to do next year? What do you want from us? Do you want to keep going? Do you want us to quit? It's all about them and their input. You know, sitting at the table with the index cards, every idea you have, write it down, send it in. This was us out at Sugar Camp, a bunch of the kids from school and some of the other people that were there, my little camp kitchen. One of our events, Andy was talking soil that day. Pretty full for a population of 500 again. These are the elders. They have a wonderful bus. When we're doing something awesome at the garden, their director puts them on the bus and brings them out to see. They thought the orchard was pretty cool, and they told us some stories about that space. That beautiful hillside is kind of its own little bowl, its own little environment. Tons of raspberries, and they were very happy that we didn't plow up all the raspberries when we planted the apple trees. But there's also a lot of medicinal plants that are growing out there. And that was a very important place for them, saying, this is over here, and that's over there. Balm of Gilead they even have out there. There's a whole little patch of Balm of Gilead trees as well, so pretty cool for me. And Hypericum, yes?
Is there another name for that?
Yes, but my brain won't find it at the moment.
Where is it from?
The trees look exactly like a popple tree, but they have a cragglier bark, and they have a smell. This time of year, the buds will get nice and big and fat and get sticky, and that's the say of Balm of Gilead.
It's a Norway poplar.
Yes, Norway poplar, thank you. There's another name for it that Rick always uses, and it's not coming to me at all. But
it's
he grabbed
local,
three buds,
right?
Off the trees and brought them to me the other day,
yeah.
And they're just phenomenal.
The salve is nice.
Yeah. It works on everything.
It's a local tree, though.
Oh, local, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I know that, yeah, because where I'm from, I know that tree, but I can't remember the name. We don't call it that.
No, it's in here somewhere. I know it is.
There's different names regionally. Like west, it's a black cottonwood.
Yeah. I mean, they have this in Alaska. That, you know, yeah. There's a guy up in Finland that actually makes and sells nice tins of the salve.
Mm. We made some. It works wonderful on arthritis.
Yes. I keep it in the car because when my hands curl up when I'm driving and use it. So it's very awesome stuff. Pictures. So the kids in the greenhouse, kids baking bread. Every year we have a harvest feast at the school. So they go out and they harvest, and then they do all of the cooking and bring their families and the community in for the feast. We do bread. Every kid makes a little artisan loaf of bread. They make soup. We have members of the community that donate rabbit and venison and grouse. And we have quite a wonderful feast that the kids prepare. They do it all. Us grown-ups are just there helping and directing, and that's it. This was a cooperation with the SHIP program in town. We had a chef come up, and we had cooks from all of the programs. So this was a Head Start cook. This is the ENP cook. This was the school in Grand Marais. And we had these gals all come out and have a little cooking class, and how do you use fresh produce? How do you use fresh produce for 60 kids or 40 kids? Our school only has 20 kids. Those great big can recipes don't work. We don't have enough people to eat it all. So cooking with whole foods is a big deal for us. These were the kids out shucking our corn. They were peeling it off the cobs so we could make hominy. The Andy teaching soil again. And these are the planters out in front of the community center and school. So this one, and then there's a break in the middle, and then that side. The other side is separated into 10-foot plots that we've allowed community members to sign up for. So people that don't have cars to get up to the garden, because that garden's like 9 miles from the village, they have their plot, and it's 3 feet wide and 10 feet long. That's 30 square feet. You can grow a lot of food in that. Where we are today, the egg production. That new field goes into production this year. The playground needs the surface finished, and then we'll be putting the fruiting plants around the outsides and along the fence. The bison program is moving forward. We need to grow grass. The school got a small grant to bring native bees into the orchard, so they got a bee house. And we're still working on, the school really wants to get honeybees, so we're still working on that. We have a community member that successfully, I think for 3 years, has had a hive in Grand Portage, and it's going well. So we're working on it.
I was going to ask about that. Is there a conflict between the indigenous bees and the honeybees?
As far as I know, no. But there is a limited amount of flowering plants for them to eat, supposedly. Not up where we are. Remember I said all of the different kinds of food that are up there?
Uh-huh.
We have a lot of stuff that's up there and it's flowering. We have a lot of food for those bees to eat. That planter in front of the school, we had some cilantro that just lost its mind. Went to seed, of course, beautiful flowers. We were there one day watching and teaching the kids not to be afraid of the bees, of course, is the big thing. But once you do and they start looking, we had 9 different kinds of bees on that cilantro, and the Montana blue, the bachelor buttons, and the other flowers that we had out
there.
Just
cool.
9 different kinds in a little spot that the kids could see and look and go, look, this one's different. There's plenty of them. And now the kids are really excited about planting even more things for them, so we will have an even healthier, hopefully, population. They're also planting milkweed this year because we want to get the butterflies plenty of as well. So they're getting very concerned about their insect brothers and sisters. But we do have a lot of stuff that's growing and blooming and is feeding the bees. This year's big projects is a kitchen remodel. The log building that we do our programs in is on the historical record, is the old school, the log building school and community center that was there. That kitchen really needs help because it's where meetings are held, the RTC meetings are held, it's where weddings and funerals and parties and gatherings are all held, and that kitchen, I mean, they did put a new floor in it because the linoleum was starting to trip people up as it curled. So we've got grants and we've got permission now. IHS was just up 3 weeks ago, the engineer gals, and said, okay, what do you need? Where do we go? Let's get the engineers in on this. We're going to be renovating that kitchen and it will be a commercial grade kitchen. So now that we're doing all of this food production, we can have everybody come in and say, hey, we've got lots of cabbage, let's everybody come in and make kraut. And we can do it in such a way that it's commercially prepared, safe, we can send it home with people. People can come in and, hey, I've got a lot of stuff in my garden, I need to, and we'll have a place for them to come and do the work. And a chicken tractor. We've got a couple of guys that are really excited about community chicken tractor. We did a thing about people having a little backyard one, but Andy's seen this one they build on a hay wagon. And the chicken house is on the hay wagon and you just drive it around the different fields and you let out the little, and the chickens go out and they do their business and then they come in and you can move it on down the road. We'll see. But that's the big thing they want to try this year. Since we have an orchard and we have all of these different garden spaces, it's starting to be a good place to put chickens. And it's certainly a doable business. There's a group called Main Street, if you want to look them up online. They are working to encourage people to start their own business using chickens. And it's working for low-income populations across the country and across the globe. I believe they're somewhat global in this, but people are actually being able to start small farms with chickens. It's doable. So, lessons learned along the way. First, why? Why do you want to do this? You saw what Andy and I do, and everybody else has full-time jobs and does what they do as well. It's a big commitment. Why? Why is it important? Why is it important to your community? And get that from them as much as you can. Because they're the ones that are going to keep this going. My grant could end tomorrow. Is the program going to end with me? Or are there enough people invested in it to keep the program going and to become a part of it? They're the teachers now. I just show up and put food on the table. It's become theirs. Community first, last, always, every step of the way. It's their project. It's their community. It's their food system. Food sovereignty. Talk about it. Tell your story. Anybody that asks a question, be prepared to answer it. Find a way. Give me your name and number. I'll get you the answer. Talk about it. Talk about it. And then listen. You know, just because you know a lot about this doesn't mean that person knows a little more about the place you're trying to do that in. Or knows somebody that's already doing it and can help you get there faster and easier. Let go of your own personal part and do what the community wants. Go in that direction. We had a guy that was really excited about the chickens 2 years ago. Really excited about the chickens. He was ready to buy chicks. And nobody was ready to have chicks at that time. The community is starting to be ready now. But he had to let it go. Because that's not where they were at. That's not what they wanted. That's not what they needed. That's not what they felt they were ready to take care of. You can't push it. You're not going to succeed that way. Do the assessment. Find the resources that are already there. Find the people that are already thinking in the same direction you are and learn to cooperate in partnership with them. Multiple fronts, singular mission. You know, Andy up there doing the garden was great. And having Emma over there cooking was great, but when the two of them started to talk, she's cooking, I like this, I need this, I can grow that. Look at the cooperation and the partnership that comes. Find out who's doing what you think you want to do, and go find them and get them in the room. And then honor place. I mean, look at the history of Grand Portage. Know what's there, what's happened, know the history, know the historical trauma, know your community well enough and get their input. Know what's there. Find the solutions that work in that place for those people. And that began that. Questions? Comments? Anything?
Great job. Great job.
Thank you very much. This was the scissor salsa. I figured I'd better put some more of that because the kids had so much fun.
I have a question about the youth involvement. Like you work with the kids through school?
Primarily through school. I go to Head Start and the school. Because we started cooking in the classrooms, there was a community center has a little after school program. Mm-hmm. One of the gals that used to be one of the teachers in elementary is over there, and she started to try to do some cooking with them in the after school program as well. We don't have a Big Brothers, Big Sisters, or Boys and Girls Club or anything, so it's kind of a random hit and miss. You know, this day you might have 3 kids, and this day you might have 12.
Yeah.
So I haven't figured out how to make enough of myself to be able to figure out how to do that. But like I said, this young woman, she's like, when there's an opportunity, she's putting it out, and she'll say, hey kids, you know, Tuesday we're going to do, and the kids are coming to that, so I'm trying to support her in doing as much of that as possible. It's been hard. The kids get it, you know, with the school and then the summer camp. We have a lot of our kids that go to Grand Marais school. So those kids are up there in the summer. That's when I get them at summer camp. And we do as much of the cooking and gardening as we can there. So those kids get that opportunity. And I'm doing a parent night class now with some of the younger families. Some of the kids have been to cooking class.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been fun to have their parents. We cook the meal that they eat. And having their parents watching them. Some of these little guys are having knife skills and their moms. They're learning that their kids know stuff and can help out at home. So we're kind of getting the skills going that way and getting the youth. Hey, it's pretty awesome for a kid that maybe doesn't feel real good about himself to be able to go home and cook bread for his family. So we're building the kids up in that way. The mentorship program in the summertime, I believe it's 13 to 15 these kids are. And they get hooked up with members of the community and follow them around and become mentors. I've had 6 so far. I think Andy's had 4 or 5. And we're working this year to try to put together a day labor pool to get the older kids, the 16 and up, if possible, and some of the local people. You know, Andy's got a day, he just needs to go plant trees. I need some guy to come and dig holes and plant trees to be able to have a list to call from. And hopefully some of our youth will go. There is a leadership, youth agricultural leadership conference done through the University of Oklahoma, I believe. We did send a young man to that. Andy worked to get him there, and he went down. And we have two kids in our education program that are going to schools in town, but they have a new food arts, culinary arts program. So there's two of them that are involved in that. So we're trying to work together and support all of these different things that we're finding the kids start to get interested in and get going on.
Do you find that the kids that are involved in the schools, when the school's done, do a lot of them, are they still involved after school lets out? Because I feel like with ACO, we have a lot of, we have 29 units of housing there, mm-hmm. and a lot of kids. And the little ones, we can do some things with baking and, you know, that kind of stuff that we do. And the middle school age kids are great, but then when they start getting to preteen and teen, mm-hmm. then it's so hard to get them. Sometimes they'll come, but then they're too cool for it.
They're too cool.
And they're too busy doing this, and they're too busy wanting to do other things. And it's like we're like struggling to try to figure out a way to
The most successful program in that respect I have seen is the, for heaven's sakes, Dream of Wild Health.
Oh, yeah.
They have, those kids are on leadership tracks, and so they have the kids come up from the city. The leaders are the kids that have been there several years.
Yeah.
And they are taking them out for conferences. There are five or six of them that have been going around since last fall. They were at the Seeds of Native Health Conference. They were at the Indigenous Farming Conference, and they're presenting at the Red Lake Food Sovereignty Conference. These are those 13 to 18 or 13 to 17 probably area that are becoming the leaders and learning to talk about it, and they're demonstrating recipes and they're teaching, and that it's hard, but they're doing it well.
You know who else is doing it well is the partnership between Glyphwick, the Forest Service, and, well, I guess it'd be the 11 member tribes, and the summer camp they have. And those kids that have, and it started out basically, for kids at risk, and getting them into the woods, and getting elders there too to teach not just wood lore, but they're learning archery, they're learning how to trap, how to hunt, and bringing back a lot of the indigenous skills. They're camped out, they're in cabins. They're not just, roughed out on the ground, but, and they've been going now for, what do they call it? Anjiaking? Mm-hmm. Anjiaking? I'm not good with Ojibwe.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Agujin is outside.
Anjiaking. Anyway. Yeah. Whatever it is. But it's a camp, and it's over on this end of the UP, so it's not close to here. But what they found is that there's a core group of Native kids that have hung in there and are now, they're now 18, 19 years old, and they're showing leadership skills in the community. And they made it through those troubling years of 12 to 16 or 12 to 18, whatever it might be, and they've kept coming back, and they've kept those bonds with other Native kids in Maine, and Native kids in Alaska that have come out to the camp, Native kids in Oklahoma that have come out to the camp. So it can happen,
mm-hmm.
But you really have to be committed, and you won't see the results for probably 10 years. But it's worth it. Oh, God, it's worth it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a young man that was in class, and he, we're doing the cooking, we're doing the gardening, and he's the one over there in the corner duck. And, I would, come on over here, why don't you do this? This is something, I try to keep involved, try to. And his mother come up to me one day, and she's, I can't thank you enough. He loves cooking. He goes home and he starts food because she works and doesn't get home till late. She came home getting ready for Thanksgiving and he'd made all the pie crust and was ready to make pies. He he doesn't look to me like a kid who wants to even be there. And yet...